Good afternoon. I'm Rosemary Bleasner, and I serve as chair of the Beyond Boundaries Advisory Group and interim dean of the College of Liberal Arts and Human Sciences. Thank you for joining us today for the Beyond Boundaries Presidential Lecture Series event with Sir David Greenaway, the Vice Chancellor of the University of Nottingham. I welcome those of you here at the Moss Center, as well as those participating through WebEx from across Virginia and across the pond at the University of Nottingham. Envisioning Virginia Tech Beyond Boundaries is an exercise in imagining a far-reaching vision of the future of Virginia Tech. Beyond Boundaries charts a course to position Virginia Tech as a top 100 global university that's responsive to the changing landscape of higher education. The purpose of the Beyond Boundaries Presidential Lecture Series is to engage with global thought leaders in higher education, to inspire new ideas, and reflect on the future of education. For today's lecture, we're pleased to have Sir David and his colleagues visiting our campus. The University of Nottingham is a global leader in higher education and has been a valuable partner to Virginia Tech for many years. I look forward to hearing Sir David's present perspective on our partnership and on future directions for higher education. At the end of the discussion, President Sands and Sir David will take questions from the audience through the Beyond Boundaries Twitter handle and Facebook page. For those participating by live stream, we will also take questions from the WebEx comments section. I encourage you to submit your questions through these platforms. Now I would like to introduce Dr. Glenda Scales, Associate Dean for Global Engagement in the College of Engineering. Glenda will describe the partnership between our two universities and introduce our speakers.
Good afternoon. This is an exciting day. And as Rosemary said, the University of Nottingham has been and continues to be a valuable partner for Virginia Tech. Nearly 10 years ago, Virginia Tech's College of Engineering and the University of Nottingham's Faculty of Engineering forged a strategic, comprehensive international research partnership. The partnership has afforded both universities opportunities to leverage research infrastructure, industry partnerships, and international funding, while providing faculty and students the opportunity to gain exposure to new research directions. An instrumental program that has helped build our collaboration is the International Research Experiences for Students program, which is an NSF-funded program from the National Science Foundation. Now it's in its fourth year. This program funds Virginia Tech undergraduate and graduate students to do summer research at Nottingham and is reciprocated by Nottingham sending some of its best and brightest to Virginia Tech for complimentary summer research. Several of the students participating in this summer's cohort are in the audience today. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce our guests for today's lecture. First, I would like to welcome Virginia Tech President Tim Sands. I would like to thank President Sands for his visionary leadership of Beyond Boundaries Initiative and the lecture series.
Thank you, Glenda.
They forgot that pause in my little notes here, right? Now, next, our guest today has led the University of Nottingham since 2008. And is a renowned economist, professor, researcher, and educational leader, Sir David Greenaway. The sixth Vice Chancellor of the University of Nottingham helped the university become one of United Kingdom's largest comprehensive research-intensive universities. In addition to our four campuses, there are three teaching hospitals in East Midlands of England. The University of Nottingham offers degree-awarding campuses in China and Malaysia. A professor of economics, Sir David also serves as chair of the Russell Group of Universities, a group representing 24 leading UK universities, including University of Cambridge, Oxford, and London School of Economics, which are all committed to producing high-quality research, outstanding teaching and learning, and amazing links with business and the public sector. Sir David was knighted in 2014 for his service to higher education. As we seek to chart our path here at Virginia Tech. There is much we can learn from his decades of education and experience. So please give a warm welcome to Sir David Greenaway.
Thanks, Tim.
Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you. Thank you. Please.
So I will provide the first question. And so President Sands and Sir David, as we begin, please tell us a little more about the Virginia Tech partnership with the University of Nottingham and why it has been successful.
Well, if you don't mind, I'll start. I think it's, first of all, thank you, Glenda, and thank you, Rosemary, and the Beyond Boundaries Committee, and our new colleagues from, you've been around with us for a decade now, but our colleagues from the University of Nottingham. It's so wonderful to have you here in our Moss Arts Center, and looking forward to the conversation. You know, I was reflecting on collaborations that have worked well for institutions of higher ed in the U.S. that I'm familiar with, and I think this one has all those features. It's multidimensional. It involves people on the ground at both places, undergraduate, graduate students, and faculty. And I think there's an element that I've learned about in my last couple of years in understanding the collaboration of the last decade with the University of Nottingham, of common approaches, common philosophies that our two institutions have. Now, one thing I notice is the emphasis on partnerships, that we understand that that we can't do it alone, that part of our strength comes from the partners we attract, and not only in higher education, but across the sectors. And that's something that I've enjoyed chatting with you about. Also, the commitment to the public good, and that being a part of, not that I think a lot of institutions have that commitment, but I think our two institutions, because of our history of access and a focus on comprehensive excellence, have always been engaged universities. And I think that's something that's very important. I could go into a lot of numbers and figures based on the collaboration, but I was impressed when I looked at our metrics, if you will. We have 30 faculty at least now engaged in collaborations. We have 3 joint positions, which I think is fascinating. And they span the entire range of engineering. And as we get into the discussion, I think it would be interesting to talk a little bit about where we might go from there. Mm. In other words, I think it's fantastic that we have a really strong engineering connection, but we have so many other parallel pieces that could be connected. I'm looking forward to seeing that relationship grow.
You know, Tim, from our standpoint, I think it's been a great success. One of the reasons it's been a great success is because it actually started bottom up. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It wasn't you or I intervening. It was our leaders in engineering intervening because they saw the potential for making the combination of the two units rather stronger than they are independently. Mm-hmm. I've been pretty pleased by what a comparatively modest investment from both our institutions has taken to leverage some activity that's impacting on our students, that's impacting on our faculty, and actually delivering really positive, worthwhile output. And I think as we've grown to know each other better over this last decade, we have discovered that there are these touch points, mm-hmm. that there's a similar kind of heritage, you know, what's baked into your psyche as a land-grant institution, what's baked into our psyche as a great civic institution in the UK, the way that makes us care about partnership, the way that makes us care about having diverse institutions. And I really do think that provides a platform for further partnership. And, you know, just over lunch, one of my vice presidents, Dame Jessica Corner, was presenting on our new research strategy and the beacons of excellence. It sounds to me as if there are areas of obvious overlap with your destinations.
Exactly.
And I look forward over the next 24 hours at conversations that might begin to think about areas outside of engineering, complementing what we do in engineering, that will take this partnership to another level.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Oh, I should mention, and this is something that I didn't understand until several years ago, and I think most of the people in the audience here understand that, but the vice chancellor in your system is equivalent to the president in our system. We have a term for vice chancellors that is a different role, but I just thought I'd mention that in case anybody in the audience here is wondering what the systems are like, yeah. And how they're the same.
Just as an aside on that, Tim, that did create us some difficulties when we first went to China, mm-hmm. because people wondered why it was a number two person that was being sent rather than number one person. Mm-hmm. And we spent an awful lot of time explaining that actually the vice chancellor is the leader of the organization. Mm-hmm. We are going to fix this, by the way. We're out.
Oh, I'm not saying you need to fix it.
We're out recruiting a new vice chancellor right now, and he or she will have the title, subject to our council in 2 weeks' time, of vice chancellor and president, and that mm-hmm. should make life mm-hmm. easier.
Very good. Thought we'd get that out of the way. I have a lot of things like we could talk about here. I'll just start off with a couple of questions and topics, but looking forward to getting into the questions in about 25 minutes
sure.
or so from the audience. What efforts have you undertaken to sustain and advance your university's global ranking and objectives? And I would say this from the standpoint that I think in the U.S., the global rankings are relatively new to us, and we've grown up with for better or for worse, various ranking systems that were based in the U.S. and really hadn't paid much attention to what's going on out there. And now we're starting to realize that it's really important that we maybe not get too locked into one ranking system, but we think about Virginia Tech in the context of the global set of partners yeah. and competitors. Yeah. You're further into this and maybe could shed some light on how much effort you put into that, what it means to your institution to be a highly ranked global institution.
So all league tables have their imperfections. I think the global tables have fewer imperfections than some of our national tables because many of them use metrics that you and I would think tell us something mm-hmm. about the quality of activity in our organizations. So it may be citations. It may be having highly cited researchers. These things do say something about the quality of the research that takes place within the institution. So we pay attention. It matters to us that we are well within the top 100 of the QS universities. And we have an institutional performance board chaired by another of our vice president that does pay attention to how we're doing on the different metrics and where we can intervene in a sensible way mm-hmm. to try and enhance our performance. But what it doesn't do is completely drive strategy. Mm-hmm. Because, of course, they miss, these global league tables miss a lot of things that are important in organizations like ours, and not just education and student experience. They also miss things like widening access. Mm-hmm. We spend a fair bit of resources, you do, in doing that because we think it's important in a UK context, in the context of the community in which we're embedded. Don't make a jot of difference to the league mm-hmm. tables. Mm-hmm. And what one would never do is to take the resources going into that to then put it in to try and drive a bit better on those league tables. So they matter. We pay attention to the metrics, but we make sure that our university strategy is not simply driven by mm-hmm. league table performance. Rather, it's driven by enhancing quality in all that we do, including those things that aren't covered by the league table.
That's refreshing to hear. I think we struggle with that as well. Our institution is a land-grant institution, as you mentioned, yeah. and it's a very engaged institution. So we recently had a group go out, and you probably read about this, into Flint, Michigan to deal with the water crisis there. And almost nothing that they did would show up in any kind yep. of metric, but it was important to us. And it's a struggle. I worry a little bit about the institutions that lock on to those metrics too much, whether they be in the U.S. or global, that they're all driving toward this to look alike in the end. And it's refreshing to hear that you use them to an extent. They're important, but they're not driving your whole strategy, which is a good thing.
And I worry in particular, if I may say so, in economies where they're still building higher education systems. Mm-hmm. And they think that the sole goal of what should be done is to get a single institution in the top 100, which kind of misses the point. Mm-hmm. The US is the most successful higher education ecosystem on the planet, but it's because it's a system mm-hmm. that has diversity, that has feeding channels, as it were, right through to the very best institutions in this country. And you don't get there by targeting a single institution in a particular league table. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Would you call your global strategy centralized, decentralized, or a hybrid? How can you describe your approach to engaging the rest of the world?
So I would say that it's been centrally driven, mm-hmm. especially when it comes to the establishment of these campuses in Ningbo in China and just outside Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia, mm-hmm. where there are 12,000 Nottingham students, 7,000 in China, 5,000 in Malaysia. But of course, it can't be completely centrally driven, because if there's no ownership deeper in the organization, then you have a problem. Mm-hmm. Now, with many of the things that we do on the internationalization front, there is deep ownership. We talked about our partnership earlier. That's here because there's real ownership within the colleges of engineering. So gradually we've had to build, where the campuses are concerned, build more commitment, more ownership within the organization. And that, of course, in time then informs the development of those institutions mm-hmm. as you change the shape, as you change the size. So a bit of both.
So your campus in Malaysia now is, 18 years old or something yeah. in nature, and in China, 2004, I believe
Correct.
It was founded. So
Correct.
You, in Nottingham, got into this business really early compared to at least institutions in the U.S. And to have 7,000 and 5,000 students, that's impressive. Have you noticed that when you came in as vice chancellor, you inherited these campuses. And you inherited them when they were fairly young, and you've sort of shepherded them through adolescence. Any surprises in how they've evolved, or has it been a well-orchestrated process?
I think well-orchestrated is overstating it, mm-hmm. because you know these are things that we were doing for the first time, and feeling our way as we mm-hmm. as we went along. We've gained in confidence as we've gone along. We've been very careful in both places to signal that this is about long-term commitment mm-hmm. and long-term value, not about short-term margin. Mm-hmm. And you know that's been important in building trust. If there's something that surprised me, the thing that surprised me is the growth in quality, mm-hmm. both in the quality of the students that we recruit. So at the Ningbo campus, the Gaokao score, which, as you know, is the national examination, is now up with Zhejiang University, mm-hmm. the premier university in Zhejiang province. That's amazing after 14 years. And then the quality of the students when they graduate, they go to top graduate schools globally. We have a real problem in Nottingham, UK, trying to attract these students because they're going to Princeton, MIT, and Oxford, and so on. And likewise in Malaysia, these are students that are highly valued in the labor market. They're doing extremely, extremely well, both as employees, as advocates for these campuses and for the university more broadly. And then on the research front, it always takes longer to build research capacity than it does to set up teaching and learning programs. But I am really pleased with the pace of development in mm-hmm. research and knowledge exchange in both places. Of course, they're not as comprehensive as back in the UK, but they're pretty comprehensive mm-hmm. for their age. And they're now beginning to lead in areas where they can lead for Nottingham globally.
Mm-hmm. So you've seen some of the developments on those two campuses come back to the campuses in the UK.
So one thing we're just talking about lunch when we talked about beacons of excellence, one of those is future food. Mm-hmm. You know, we have this big issue. We've got 7 billion people on this planet, and by 2050, that'll be 9 billion. We already have issues with food security. Mm-hmm. So can we discover underutilized tropical crops that might reduce our really perilous dependence on the three core staples? Mm-hmm. So we have this center in Malaysia called Crops of the Future, which the Malaysian government funded. Now, we can do this stuff under glass houses in Nottingham. There we can do it at field scale, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. in the tropics, in situ. The example I'd give from from China. Ningbo is now the biggest port, not in China, the biggest port in the world. So what they call the marine economy is really important to them. We don't have any real capacity in aspects of the marine economy in Nottingham, UK. But we did put to the Ningbo municipal government that we could build competitive research and knowledge transfer activities in the marine economy, smart materials, port logistics, novel pharmaceuticals. And they have invested in a major new facility on that campus. I think that will help build complementary activity in Nottingham, UK.
Mm-hmm. Do a number of your students in the UK then cycle through the campuses in China and Malaysia?
Not enough, mm-hmm. is my answer on that. Right now, there are 122 students from Nottingham, UK in Ningbo, and there's 80-something from Nottingham, UK in Malaysia. Mm-hmm. And I and we think that should be much bigger. It's growing more slowly than we would like. And some of that is perhaps about the offer. You know, mm-hmm. it's either a semester or a year, so we need to be a bit more inventive and create more summer schools. Mm-hmm. Some of it is about them being with their peers. Mm-hmm. So it's not unusual to speak with students at an open day. And I take a real example of a student I spoke with that said he was going to do economics and Chinese studies. And therefore, he was going to spend some time at the Ningbo campus. And then I still teach a year one class in economics. I see the student. I ask him when he's going to China. He said, well, actually, you know what? I'm here. I've got my friends.
Yeah.
It's a great place to live. You know, I've got this girlfriend now. And
well, so, for us, it's football in the fall.
The problem.
Yeah, we struggle with that. Yes.
So we may need to begin to think about sending cohorts and developing programs where it's compulsory.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This is a kind of a long-range question, but you're familiar with Beyond Boundaries and what
yes.
we're trying to do with that in terms of visioning out about 30 years. If you would maybe venture to project where the University of Nottingham will be in 30 years, I know that's a tall order, but maybe it's more of a wish list of where you'd like to be. What would that look like? What would the University of 2047 look like?
That's a really tough one.
Oh, I know. It's
That's
not really,
really
fair.
It's a really tough one.
But I'm just curious, when you dream and...
If I think of the higher education landscape globally, I think it will be an even more globalized higher education landscape than we have at the moment. When you look at, the demography globally and you look at the projections that the OECD make of the number of international students who will be living outside their country mm-hmm. of domicile. I just see, more mobility mm-hmm. over that period. I see more diversity in the student body. You know, we're in a world where the thing that's really hard to work out the impact of is technology.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how is it going to change the way we organize ourselves? How is it going to change the way in which we engage with our students? How's it going to change what goes on in the classrooms and laboratories? That's really tough, but we do know that technology will accelerate job turnover. And I think that will mean that universities like ours have to think much harder about both the age range of the student body mm-hmm. and much harder about the way in which we deliver programs. And rather than coming in at 18 and going out at 22, having done your 360 or 480 credits, we might need to be thinking of models where you can do 60 credits as you transition from one job to another mm-hmm. and bank those and come back 18 months later or 2 years later or 4 years later at your next job transition.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to think very hard about that. I think the one thing I remain quite confident about, despite being uncertain about the impact of technology, is that place will still be important.
Mm-hmm.
I still think that places like Virginia Tech and places like the University of Nottingham, that are these communities that help transform individuals, not just through what goes in the laboratories and the classrooms and the clinics, but even more importantly, what goes on outside, will still be places that people come to for the face-to-face engagement, for the interaction, and for all the other activities that take place outside of formal education.
I'd agree with you. I think a lot of our students learning when they're in Blacksburg, especially our undergraduates, is really the developing the skills that can only be developed in person, yep. at least with today's technology. But can be, and it's not just during the classes, it's during 24-hour experience that they have. And I don't think that will go away either. But one of the things we learned from our Beyond Boundaries exercise, I remember we gathered the students together. I think they were undergrads, but I think the graduate students had a similar conclusion, that they dream of, yes, Blacksburg's a base camp, but they want to be anywhere in the world, on any continent,
yep.
and have no interruption in their studies, essentially be able to have a seamless transition from being in Blacksburg to being somewhere in China to being in Colombia or wherever it may be, and not have to skip a step. Just keep moving on their curriculum, but have it be engaged and learning in the place they're in, but always connected. That's a technological and regulatory and every challenge is there, but our students, I think, have a very ambitious vision, and I hope we can get there.
I think plausible and feasible.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of experiential learning, I know both of our campuses value that greatly. Mm. Just be curious to hear what University of Nottingham is doing to build that into the curriculum and how far you've come already.
So let me start with what we've just been talking about in terms of student mobility. So although I'd like to see more at the China-Malaysia campuses, it is the case that 23% of our undergraduates get some international experience. And mm-hmm. I don't mean a field course, I mean a meaningful mm-hmm. international experience. So that's important because of the enrichment that takes place, because of the capacity to adapt, the adaptability mm-hmm. Of going and spending time in another culture. We also have a whole range of offers under something called the Nottingham Advantage Award. And this may be working with a small and medium-sized enterprise in the city. It may be working in the third sector. It may be getting credit for volunteering work in one of our Nottingham Potential schools, one of our Nottingham Potential centers. It may be being involved in an undergraduate program that's got an internship mm-hmm. commitment. There's a sense in which I almost don't care what it is, so long as we get them out doing these things mm-hmm. because of the enrichment that takes place and because of the value that they can add in the process, especially if they're going into disadvantaged communities or schools in disadvantaged areas.
But it does take money. Many of these activities require either support from the university or some subsidy in some form, especially for students who don't come from wealthy backgrounds to maybe not be able. Our challenge here, for example, is some of our students can't leave or feel like they can't leave because they can't sublet their apartment and then rent another apartment in another city. And we're constantly struggling with that barrier. For us, it's going to be essentially mean raising private philanthropy along yep. those lines. But it is a challenge.
But it's like everything else, Tim, isn't it? If you think it's worthwhile, then you've got to mm-hmm. harvest the resources to mm-hmm. invest. And those activities, I think, are essential as opposed to desirable.
One of the things we learned from, we had a Gallup do a survey of our alums, and mm-hmm. They interviewed thousands of them. And we learned a lot from that survey in terms of the student experiences that are associated with well-being in later life and all sorts of dimensions, engagement in the workplace. There are associations. The causality is not established without beyond a shadow of a doubt. But there's enough association that you can learn some things that could be implemented or could affect the way that you design experiential learning programs, for example. Because we did find out that those kind of experiences, especially if they were more than a semester, maybe a year or yep. 2 years in length, had tremendous association with well-being in later life and engagement in the workplace. You mentioned you basically want to make sure that everybody has some kind of engagement like that, but have you collected any data or any information that would lead you to conclude what kind of outcomes are measurable and is there a point where it's a worthwhile experience, or is it always just worthwhile to get the students out there and engaged?
I think the latter first and foremost. Mm-hmm. Of course, you want them to be meaningful and purposeful, and you want to add value to another party as well as adding value to the student. Do we systematically collect data? No, I don't think we do. My metric for this would be what happens to the students when mm-hmm. they finish. Mm-hmm. And our employability rates are fantastic. Just this last year, the Times and Sunday Times awarded us the University of the Year for graduate employment. That's not the be-all and end-all, but it's, mm-hmm. but it is a market test. It's mm-hmm. telling us something about the outputs of the, mm-hmm. the process. And that isn't, I'm convinced, isn't just about what they do in the classrooms and the labs. Mm-hmm. It's about all these other mm-hmm. things that are, developing people who are curious, who have the right kind of values, who do want to give back in all kinds of ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've seen that those engaged experiences lead to the ability to communicate, to work in a diverse team on a complex problem, and you learn a lot when you're having to look at different points of view and working with people whose experiences are very different than yours. And the ability to reduce data to actionable information is something that it requires a realistic environment, not a simulated environment. Indeed. To be under that kind of pressure and be able to make that happen. So I'm looking forward to seeing what both of our institutions do in the future. I think for Virginia Tech, it's somewhat aspirational, even though we have a large number of our students engaged in undergraduate research and internships, co-op, study abroad. We're still, I think, at the point of really trying to understand what are those experiences are really valuable and which ones are just good to do, but maybe leading up to something mm-hmm. more substantial. How does University of Nottingham encourage global citizenship and service among its students and faculty, for that matter?
And I think it's right. It's both. I think first and foremost by getting them to think in global perspectives rather than just local or mm-hmm. national perspectives. And I think the nature of the institution with this in a UK context unique global footprint helps to signal that in a very important way. Secondly, through the development of the curriculum in all of the campuses to try and build in areas of global challenge, mm-hmm. because most of the big challenges that we face are global challenges rather than local challenges. And then thirdly, by trying to get them involved in international experiences, mm-hmm. staff mm-hmm. as well as students. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Very good. I think it'd be a good time to transition to questions from the audience. I've got a pad here that's got a list of questions that are coming in, and I'd encourage you to continue to submit them. But let me start with a graduate student named Anna. And she asks, in this ever-changing landscape of higher education, what challenges and opportunities do you foresee in reference to international enrollments, and how do you endeavor to address these challenges?
So international enrollments, I would start from the most recent OECD projections. And at the moment, there's about 4.1 million international students who study outside of their country of domicile. And OECD are forecasting that 2025, 2026, that will double to 8 million. So that's an opportunity. It's an opportunity for all of us to further diversify the population of our institutions, and that's got to be a good thing, because diversity is within any population is a good thing. What are the challenges? Actually, it's just getting more competitive to recruit mm-hmm. the best students out there, because once upon a time it was really about the top US universities and the top UK universities and Canada and Australia and New Zealand, because the English language gave us this absolute advantage. That absolute advantage has been eroded. It's been eroded because across Western Europe, for instance, many institutions are increasingly teaching English. There are institutions in China that teach in English, and it's a big priority for China to bring international students to China. They have a target by 2020 to have 500,000 international students in that country. It's 355,000 at the moment. So it is increasingly competitive, And that will mean that we need to think, you know, carefully about the offer in terms of the mm-hmm. curriculum. We can think carefully about the facilities that we offer these students who are making big investments to come to our institutions. And we need to think pretty carefully about the competition.
Are you in a position, I don't know how your finances work, but are you in a position to provide financial incentives to international students? Does the UK government encourage that, or is that something that's forbidden?
So the UK government's agnostic on it, mm-hmm. to be honest, in the sense that with the exception of the Home Office that looks after, you know, visas and whatnot, pretty well all government departments understand that this is a very important export activity mm-hmm. to the United Kingdom. And therefore they encourage recruitment of international students and they encourage broader transnational education. But it's just all warm words. There's no resource that goes into it. And that applies to, for the most part, to scholarships. Mm-hmm. There are some government agencies like the British Council that do provide some, you know, some support. So what that means is if we want to put support in, we have to self-finance. Mm-hmm. So for instance, we have a program we call Developing Solutions, which is targeted at master students in countries from low-income economies, mainly sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia. And that's entirely self-funded. That's a couple of hundred students a year, but that's self-funded. Mm-hmm. And you know, we top slice the resource for that. And there are many areas, for example, PhD support, where we are providing mm-hmm. our own resources to do that.
Mm-hmm. I think in the US universities, especially publics, the PhD support is something that is agnostic to some degree of country of origin. Not entirely, but to some degree. But undergraduate studies is very difficult to find a way to resource that for international students, mm-hmm. and that's something we do struggle with. I think the question, I don't know who asked it, I know it's Anna, but may have been motivated to some extent by the local politics of the
right.
moment
in
the U.S. And you know, it is a concern. Right now we're in the admission cycle, and we've admitted and we're waiting to hear back from our prospective students. And the undergraduates have another 2 weeks. The graduate students have a little longer, depending on what program and which university you're talking about. But we're on pins and needles in terms of mm-hmm. who's going to accept, are they going to be able to get their visas in time? I think we'll get through it, but it is a challenging time in the U.S. for that.
No, we've observed that, and
you're not taking advantage of it, are you? Though
we'd never take advantage. We have similar challenges ourselves. Don't forget with the referendum that took place
right.
in the UK last mm-hmm. Last June, which you know has had a bit of a dislocation effect on many of our staff and students from other European Union mm-hmm. member states who are kind of wondering, well, are we still welcome in the UK? But that's something that we've been managing locally.
I see Theresa May, was it today?
Today, this morning.
I wouldn't call it monkey wrench, but put a little surprise element into the
She
equation.
Took us all by surprise, actually.
Or is that right? You didn't know ahead of time. The second question we have is from Jamie, the graduate student. It says, your Global Strategy 2020 aims at addressing the changing expectations of students. What do you see as some of the biggest changes, and how is the University of Nottingham addressing them? And I think you've touched on this in a couple of ways in your answers, but is there anything else you'd like to add there?
It's a great question. And I'd go back, first of all, to technology. You know, the undergraduates that come into our universities these days are very different in terms of the way they learn, very different visual literacy skills. They're very different in terms of how they want to engage with faculty. I worry that we may not be responding quickly enough to that. Just next Monday, we'll be looking at, you know, back home at how we respond with investment in our digital assets. Mm-hmm. But I do worry we may not be responding quickly enough.
Things are changing quickly, they're accelerating, and often I think it's because I'm getting older and my future is getting shorter, and somehow that turns into relative acceleration, but it's not true. It's really, it is happening.
It is.
One of the things I was just kind of laughing about and kind of proud of is our dining services folks introduced a program in the last couple of days where, and I don't think I'm supposed to publicly announce this, I think they're doing a soft rollout, but oh well. You're probably not using them, most of the people in the audience, but you can now from your residence hall room or your apartment, I guess, order your lunch and have it delivered or ready for you when you arrive. You can come and pick it up instead of having to stand in line. I think that's a little things like that we often forget about, but this is the expectation of this generation. It's not quite as sophisticated as the burrito drop we had last year from drones, but you know, that's a whole other story. Yeah, I agree. I think the our students are they're thinking in different ways. They're thinking about branding themselves through experiences. They're thinking about moving from one position to the next with relative fluidity. They don't. I think we're trying to develop entrepreneurial skills in our students, not because we necessarily want them to start companies, but they need to have that kind of resilience to bounce from one career step to the next. You know, When I got involved, I graduated or got my PhD. I joined a company, I thought I was going to retire there. I really did. Yeah. I couldn't believe. Yeah. Looking back, I think that was so crazy. But this generation, they know that they're going to be bouncing around. They'll be working all over the world. And it doesn't seem to faze them, which I find amazing.
But resilience is exactly the right word.
Mm-hmm. We have a question on Twitter from Tracy. Oh, by the way, are you on Twitter?
No.
Do you plan to tweet?
Perhaps after I retire.
Yes, we were just talking about that earlier. Yeah. Sir David has a plan to retire, to move on to the next phase in September, and has been working on this for a while. And I would wait, but we have in the U.S. we have no choice.
Yeah.
And it's actually been a good way to connect for me. But I would. You can become a real fiend on Twitter without the constraints of your position. So we look forward to seeing what you actually tweet in September.
Look out for it.
Here, this is from Tracy on Twitter. As we encourage students to think outside the box, how do we help manage creativity? How do we break down those boundaries?
Do we try and manage it, or do we just provide more opportunities? And I would think the latter. So the Thursday before we came out, I went and presented a prize at our annual Ingenuity Awards. This is something we started about 5 years ago, and it's seed funding for student entrepreneurship or alumni entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. 3 or 4 years ago, we would maybe have 50 or 60 entries. This year, we had 600 entries, which we narrowed down to top 22, that then benefited from £113,000 in financial support. That's just a fabulous story for me, in that we've done little else but put the infrastructure in there and the seed funding and created the opportunity, and this creativity has just exploded. Mm-hmm. And there's some real businesses coming through this. One that won the entrepreneurial prize for the fastest growing company is called Hungry Panda. Mm-hmm. This Chinese student that set up a business that's now in 6 cities where Chinese students can order Chinese food online. And he makes connections with different providers in different places, and it's a way.
You raise an interesting point, though. Of course, we've seen similar kinds of things at Virginia Tech and at campuses around the country where where you provide the opportunity, as you put it, and the students come in droves, and with mentors, these things really take off. The challenge I think we've had is that building that into the curriculum, or building space into the day, if you will, to allow that to happen, and then looking for, are there outcomes, learning outcomes that can be achieved through those experiences that can be credited to the students, so they're not feeling like they have a successful business and have to take 2 years off of their curriculum. Not that you mentioned that earlier, that may be a desirable way to think about education, but it's a challenge. Have you built those experiences into curricula yet, or is that
we haven't. And I do wonder whether we sometimes over-engineer these things. That you know, as soon as we begin to think about building it in, mm-hmm. you know, we get into the, you know, dare I say, the bureaucracy of, mm-hmm. you know, how do we score it, how do we evaluate it, how many credits it's worth, right. et cetera, rather than perhaps taking a, you know, a bit more of a punt mm-hmm. and saying, well, you know, let's try and evaluate it in a more light touch way mm-hmm. and, you know, give some credit mm-hmm. so that it does become part of the curriculum. But if we go down the route of trying to box it into mm-hmm. something that looks like a module or half a module, we'd probably destroy it.
No, I think you're right on that. It's a challenge, but I think you're right. We have from Twitter, Maria, what changes might we need in K through 12 or earlier education to lay the groundwork for globally minded higher ed students and institutions?
What a great question. What a great question. I think trying to help schools, and I mean, this is, at one level, this isn't our job, but trying to help schools that we're associated with to create more international opportunities for their students. So the week before last, a bunch of us were in Ningbo, mm-hmm. University of Nottingham, Ningbo, China. I didn't know, but there were about 20, 25 students from a Nottingham school called Carton the Willows that we work with out there for 10 days, mm-hmm. which is fantastic. I mean, it's absolutely fantastic. What an experience for those youngsters. And you know, they will instantly go back knowing something about China, knowing something about the, you know, the excitement of being in Asia. Thinking a bit differently about that country when they hear it mentioned in the news or whatever. So I think, you know, opening up in ways that we can, that will help those schools that we're associated with to, you know, to make connections, mm-hmm. maybe with other schools that we're associated with in China or Malaysia or indeed elsewhere.
I think at Virginia Tech, we realized in the last couple of years that we can't just wait to see who shows up at the front door at age 18. Even though we're not funded for it, somehow we have to reach out.
Yeah.
And that's a fascinating dimension to it that I don't think we've really considered yet. We have a program called College Access Collaborative where we're reaching into rural and urban communities that don't typically send students to Virginia Tech for various reasons. And we're supporting their curriculum, giving them some resources to create pathways for students who wouldn't normally come to Virginia Tech. But adding a global dimension to that and bringing our global connections to that, I think is something that is worth doing. So we should continue that conversation.
And it could be in the virtual world. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have to actually involve, you know, taking the, mm-hmm. the individuals out there.
Mm-hmm. It's very true. Here's an interesting, kind of provocative question, and this may be our last one. This is coming via WebEx from Dustin. And the question is, when does global become too big?
When does global become too big? So where are the boundaries? I think that would be my answer to that. You know, we've gone through a process, if you think of the period from roughly 1950 through until the crash in 2008, of just astonishing globalization of activity. A lot of it driven by technology. We've seen a bit of a blip post-2008, post-Eurozone crisis, a little bit of a slowdown, but do I see it changing much over the next generation? No, I think I see it accelerating, partly because a lot of these global connections you can't reverse. You know, the first time I flew to the US was in 1981. It may or may not have been on a Boeing 707, but let's assume it was. When Boeing built 707s, 1% of their components were sourced outside the United States. On Friday, we flew in a 777 Dreamliner. 70% of those components are sourced outside the United States. You can't reverse that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the, you know, this ever more connected digital world that we live in, we'll just see that process continue. So I don't see limits to globalization.
I wonder if, I don't know if Dustin's connecting to us from Nottingham or from the U.S., but from our perspective as a state university, there are some tensions because we're funded by the Commonwealth of Virginia to be principally an institution for Virginia. So the global mission that you would get consent to in Richmond, in our state capital, would be bringing the rest of the globe to Virginia, bringing partners to Virginia, catalyzing the growth of businesses that have global origins that will do business in Virginia. Very few people would object to that. Yeah. But what we've seen, I think, with the transition over the last 50 years or so of a state institution like Virginia Tech to back then, many of the students who graduated stayed in Virginia. At least that was the theory. I think a lot of them did scatter around in their careers, but the thinking was that you were investing in a student who was going to contribute directly to Virginia. Now we've come to a point where our graduates, some of them, we're fortunate that we have opportunities for our students in Virginia, even international students and students coming from other states. But there's a sense when you go to our state capitals that they think we've become, in a way, too global of an institution, so why should we fund that, at least on a student basis, if those students aren't locked into staying in their state? And a good example of this just popped up in the news a couple days ago when the state of New York made college education essentially free in their two big systems, the State University of New York and City University of New York. With thousands and thousands of students, they have a deal now that you, if your education's paid for and it's essentially free, you have to stay that same number of years in New York State. And so I think we've got a little, maybe you don't have that problem, but we have a little bit of the parochialism that stays to this day. And it's driven just by economics, but it's a tension that works against going out, even though a place like Virginia Tech, we're absolutely committed to being a global institution, but there are these forces that are subtly working against us.
No, I can see the political problem. I think I'd have two comments. One is, in terms of building that value within the Commonwealth, that can only be assisted, I think, by going out. Mm-hmm. So you've got a Rolls-Royce UTC. Rolls-Royce is a UK company. It's a global company. Mm-hmm. And it's got these UTCs all over the planet. I think by going out and engaging with your equivalent UTCs and building partnerships with them, that can only help, I think, the UTC here and the Rolls-Royce presence in the Commonwealth Centre for Advanced Manufacturing. Mm-hmm. I think the other one, the State University of New York, I mean, that's in other areas of activity, that's quite, that return of service model is quite a common model, isn't it? That if you're going to get something, if you're going to get this investment for this period, then we need the return of service for 3 years or 4 years or whatever. In principle, I don't have a problem with that. I mean, it's something that I think happens in your military, it happens in our military. It's something that's being considered at the moment in the UK in relation to medical education. Mm-hmm. And if these things have huge public investments, I don't see a trade-off between doing that, but at the same time maintaining this global perspective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think in some ways we, and I don't know if you have this challenge as well, I think we have to change the way we tell our story to our stakeholders. Yeah. For 50 years or so, we've been talking about the investment they make in our undergraduates from Virginia, and I think that curve has, or that we've slid down that curve far enough that we need to have a different message about the value of that Virginia Tech brings to the Commonwealth, more in line with the partners we can bring in and the economic growth associated with it, and hopefully rising everyone's economic well-being in the Commonwealth by not only bringing in business but reaching out and engaging all of our communities. So I think it's a storytelling problem that we have that we have to address.
I agree with that, and that extends to assets like this that we're sitting in here. You know, the contribution that universities like yours and mine make to cultural capital. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes this is funded by alumni who live overseas.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Well, thank you for this very enriching discussion. Is there anything you'd like to add to close?
Only to say, I mean, a very big thanks to you and to your colleagues, Tim, for the welcome that me and my colleagues have received. We're here as a, you know, quite a big group, and that just reflects the value that we place on this partnership. It's been a fantastically warm reception. I'm really looking forward to the next 24 hours, and indeed when we go to see what you've got in the National Capital on on Friday. And I do hope that we can find other touch points to build on what our engineers have created here, and to see that partnership extend in other areas of sciences and social sciences.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Well, thank you. Like to join the audience in thanking you for making this trip along with your delegation.
Thanks very much.
It's been a stimulating discussion.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Enjoyed it.
Yeah. Thank you.
I hope you've got the